All right, that was a good way to start it off.
Yeah.
Oh boy. Hello, everyone. Welcome to this episode 5 of the Bangers, Bops, and Banter podcast.
Yeah.
Episode 5?
Yeah, it's our Empire Strike. It's our Empire Strikes Back. So, get ready for. It's all downhill from here. I'm one of your hosts, Joe. I'm with my co-host, Brendan.
I'm the co-host, Brendan.
Damn. That was a really good introduction. And yeah. We got some guests today. We have Jason.
Hello.
We have Nuno.
Howdy.
Oh boy, we got a cool show coming up. I don't know. We got some music and movie news stories we can discuss. Afterwards, we're gonna review/discuss the Rodriguez album Cold Fact. And then finally, we're gonna talk about some movies that I don't think any our guests have watched.
Did you guys read the Harry Potter books as a kid?
I've watched the Harry Potter movies.
Okay. All right, cool.
I've watched a few of the movies.
I read the first 2 books when I was 10 years old, so you know I have it all stored away somewhere up there.
You only read the first 2 books?
No, I read up to Order of the Phoenix and then I quit because it was large.
Yes, thank you.
Yes, it is large.
And boring?
And boring.
It damn!
I mean, Goblet of Fire, also very large, but very fun at the same time.
Goblet of Fire slapped.
Yeah, exactly. Cedric
bombed.
Damn.
The whole show is destroyed because of what Jason said.
No, I am 100% in agreement with Jason here.
Order of the Phoenix damn. Was like, oh, we learned spell in the mirror room. Yay. And then that's it. Like,
I mean, like,
and then that ugly lady gets like, yeah, she has cats and whatever.
Yeah, I don't know if she had cats, but like Umbridge, in hindsight, was cool. As a kid, I didn't care about Umbridge. Gonna be honest.
Damn.
I was just like,
you didn't care about Umbridge?
Mean.
Yeah. You think she was cool?
Like as a character concept, in hindsight, yes, she is an interesting character concept.
Sure.
She definitely did not get raped by centaurs. It's okay.
Yeah. It's a kid's so explicitly.
Is that POM?
We don't care anymore. That's the beauty.
We're not on the radio.
Now we just have to be concerned about YouTube.
Yeah.
We're not getting monetized for any of this anyways.
That's fair.
Since you're not on the radio anymore, I can say they can go fuck themselves.
Hey.
Ooh.
Yeah, fuck the radio.
Yeah. All my homies listen to Spotify.
That's true.
I've never used the radio in my car.
It's not true what they say. Video didn't kill the radio star. We killed the radio star.
Mm-hmm. Oh, fuck.
Honestly, streaming services did. Like,
yep.
It's no point. You can just curate your own music so easily now.
Yeah. Well, do we want to get into some cool news stories?
Yeah.
Wow. Alright, the guitar pedal company Fulltone has been dropped by a lot of retailers because their founder made a bunch of bad statements.
Uh-oh.
Whoopsies.
No, Papa John.
I don't think... I'm pretty sure that's not... Didn't Papa John say the N-word?
Yeah, Papa John
said the N-word.
And then he sweatily ate like 30 pizzas, right?
What was it? Let's not forget the fact that he was also apparently like big on the sexual assault and like sexual harassment, so...
Oh, fuck. I did not know about that.
Yeah. I didn't know about that either. I just knew he said the N-word.
He liked grabbing asses and telling women how much he'd like to fuck them.
Yikes.
Ooh! Yeah. Alright.
Papa John's is cancelled?
Papa John has been cancelled.
Yeah.
Damn.
He did call for the Requiem that is we are now suffering through, so...
Oh, fuck.
Wait, what?
Yeah, well, he said around the time that he ate the 30 pizzas, he's like, they're going to get what's coming to them. And then two executives died mysteriously, and then... So basically, this is all Papa John.
So Papa John is actually a god, is what I'm hearing. Or probably, perhaps.
Mayhaps. So, how about that Full Tone?
Yeah. So the Full Tone's founder said bad things. Specifically on the George Floyd situation, he said, and I quote, what is this, like, night four of looting with 100% impunity? The pussy mayor and governor don't give a shit about small businesses, and it's never been more clear. He wrote in a since-deleted Facebook post on June 2nd. There's a second. He later added a comment, quote, I feel better and flushed out some prissy boys who were raised to pee sitting down. Now I'll delete.
Yikes.
Big yikes. Naturally a bunch of places like Guitar Center and various other retailers just completely dropped Full Tone. Not saying bad things is important.
Isn't it?
Yeah. Wow. It's really hard not to say dumb things sometimes, though.
I don't know. This was a Facebook post. This isn't like you accidentally said something. This is like you took the time.
He obviously meant what he said, but like, I feel like had he even like run it by one person, just been like, hey Jimmy, you think this is okay? I think Jimmy would have been like, you know what, Bob, let's just take it a step back.
Damn. We got some more news. The Lady Antebellum are changing their name to Lady A. Because I believe Lady Antebellum is a figure associated with American slavery, and they're like, hey, we didn't realize, they didn't realize it, but they didn't take into account the associations. So they're changing their name to Lady A. Surprisingly, or I guess not so surprisingly, there is a blues singer called Lady A who is really annoyed that they're changing their name to Lady A.
Wow.
Just
rebrand entirely. Give yourself like a metal band name, I think, is really the play.
Yes. Oh my god.
I'm interested to know how, after 14 years, you couldn't figure out the associations.
Yeah, I feel like it was just something they didn't, like, think about. And then, like, I don't know, maybe someone brought it up to them or something.
Like, how'd they come up with their name in the first place, though?
I believe it says, a quote from Lady Antebellum, they say, when we set out together almost 14 years ago, we named our band after the Southern Antebellum-style home where we first took our photos.
Ah,
okay.
Interesting. I don't know. Well...
So they weren't trying racist. No, that's the important
no.
thing.
Or that's Antebellum what they're putting up in the media.
Means... It's Latin for literally before the war, so I guess the Antebellum style means the style of house that was before the Civil War. So it's not overtly racist, but it does have racist roots.
Yeah, I mean, it's like kind of like saying, you remember the good old days when we had slavery and stuff like that? You know?
Yeah.
So not the best look.
Well, we also got Andre 3000 has released t-shirts for Black Lives Matter. I believe all the proceeds go to Black Lives Matter, or I guess the profits. So it's cool. Let's go, Andre.
Yeah, so it looks like he's selling the t-shirts with the same messages on the jumpsuits he wore for his 2014 tour.
Yeah.
I remember I saw those jumpsuits a long time ago. And yeah, I think it's a very significant style, and I think that it's a good thing to spend on if you want to support Black Lives Matter.
Yeah.
I think it sends a very significant and, I don't know what the word I'm looking for is. I don't know. Just a good message. It's very to the point, and it's very poignant at the same time.
Yeah, definitely. I guess moving on to some movie news. So Tenet, the new Christopher Nolan film, was originally going to come out on July 17th. It's been pushed back to July 31st and will now to be like released with movie theaters like starting to reopen. Which is interesting. I'll be interested to see how movie theaters are going to deal with the reopening.
Yeah, I saw, regarding this movie, I think there was a quote that I saw earlier, like a month ago, that said, if Tenet fails, like, no new movies until 2021, or something like that.
Oh yeah, definitely. Or actually, I don't know if theaters are reopening with Tenet, because I think they're, what is it? Warner Bros. Said that they're re-releasing Inception on July 17th for Inception's like 10th anniversary.
I can't imagine that's gonna do terribly well though.
Well, yeah, but I figure it's. I assume they kind of want to like ease into it, so.
That makes sense.
But all, it's. As much as I'd like to see Tenet in theaters, I don't know how, like, I don't know if I'm, like, that ready to see it, to actively go to one yet.
Oh, no, definitely not. Not yet, personally.
Yeah. So it'll be interesting to see how it does. In wake of all this.
I don't have high hopes, honestly.
Yeah. And then our final article, AMC, this is actually released a little while ago, but I just found out about it. AMC has substantial doubt that it will remain in business, or it can remain in business. Which is...
This is, like, pretty incredible, honestly.
Yep.
Yeah. It expects to have lost between 2.1 and 2.4 billion in the first quarter. Which is a lot. Which... I guess it's just really surprising, considering how... giant AMC is as a chain.
No, yeah, they're like easily one of the biggest movie theaters. It's like them and darn, I can't remember the other big
Showtime
cinemas. Yeah, right?
Cinemas, yeah.
They're like super huge, and their coronavirus essentially just killed them. And who knows if movie theaters were ever like really come back?
Do you think we would see an influx of private theaters after this?
How do you know? Like, that's a big investment.
I would love to see that. I mean, I love the charm of private theaters.
I like private theaters. They tend to be less clean, and honestly, though, and like less comfortable than like some of the more.
I don't go to a movie theater to be comfortable.
It definitely, like, depends on the AMC you're going to.
Okay.
Because, like, I don't know, the one near us is, like, actually, like, really good quality.
Yeah, I really love the one that I usually go to, so. They are expensive, though. That's one problem.
They are. It's definitely, like, it'll be interesting to see how they deal with this. I find it, like, surprising that, like, a business this big can't, like, as soon as, like, something like this happens, they're just, like, done. They have no, like, way to survive it.
I'm guessing, I mean, so they made, like, $941 million in the first quarter, I think, versus $1.2 billion in the first quarter last year.
Yeah.
I think the problem isn't their quarterly reports right now, I think it's the prospects of the future. Because even after restrictions are fully lifted, you're going to have some people not as enthusiastic to go back into a place like a movie theater, where multiple people might sit in the same chair as you on a day-to-day basis.
Speaking of enthusiasm, have numbers been released for the Scooby-Doo movie? There's a reason why I bring this up.
I don't know if numbers have been released for the Scooby-Doo movie. I do know there was the Trolls sequel had numbers released. I don't know about Scooby-Doo.
Just because, like, and this is kind of, I'm not at all original in this thought. This has been one of those things that's been presented by people who are better at movies than I. But the whole idea that one day streaming movies is going to end up taking over and physical cinemas will just die out. And I think if something like the Scooby-Doo movie or the Trolls movie, if those did well enough, we may end up seeing a full shift where nobody pays for AMC theaters. And I think that's kind of what AMC is afraid of, is if these direct-to-video movies somehow did well enough that people can just say, why would I want to go to a movie theater when I can just sit at home and pay, you know, $10 and watch this movie? It may end up just being complete decimation, you know?
Yeah, I know. I think we talked about this in a previous episode, but
I think we talked about it last week with Mike. Maybe.
Did we do it? No, I know we did it earlier. I believe before. It just, what was it, the Trolls World Tour, I remember Universal released numbers, and they're really happy with how much it made from rentals, and they actually said that they, from now on, they'd be releasing it, the movies, in theaters and digitally. They release it for, like, $20 digitally. I say that's reasonable for, like, because for something like, yeah, for day of, for something like Trolls World Tour, if you're, like, a family, it's, like, pay $20 to just have it at home instead of going out to the theater and having to hassle with all of it.
See, I do wonder if these production companies are actually losing money by not doing it that way. I personally, I mean, like, I'm willing to wait for a movie to come digital if I'm not enthusiastic about seeing it in theaters already.
Yeah, definitely. I believe one other thing to note is, like, in response to Universal saying this, AMC, like, was pretty furious, and they just straight up banned Universal movies from their theaters. Because they don't want other companies to, like, get the idea that, oh, we can also release digital and make more money. And consequently, like, make or like decimate AMC's business.
Well, I think that's another good reason that AMC is going to go under this year.
Yeah, definitely. I will say that I think it's probably part of the reason Trolls World Tour did so well is because it's a family, like, animated movie. Because I can definitely see a family being like, yeah, I'll definitely, like, pay $20 to watch this for, and have my, or our children be distracted for 2 hours. But compared to, like, was there's like the Invisible Man that came out earlier this year, which was also on streaming, which I think also was very successful in streaming. But like personally, I wouldn't pay like $20 to just watch that. I'd wait for it to drop.
What is a movie that, like a recent movie that just released digitally? Did Marriage Story make it to theaters?
That was on Netflix.
It was just
I think it was. It had a limited release in theaters because the Oscars are shitty. And if you want to be considered for Oscars, you have to release in theaters, or at least that was the case until coronavirus happened.
Yeah, I wanna be able to compare like actual box office success with home release success.
Yeah, because one of the problems with like something releasing on Netflix, like The Irishman was released on Netflix. And like it had like a budget of $160 million. Netflix like poured a fuck ton of money into it. But also Netflix, compared to like a film that's just released in theaters, Netflix doesn't make money from like, it's not like a one-to-one thing where it's like you put out this film for a certain budget and then it makes X amount of money. It's like they build up like an amount of content to draw people to their streaming service,
right?
Which is something that's been hard, so it's been hard to compare like Netflix streaming to in theaters. Because there have been films that done incredibly well on Netflix, but, like, you can't compare, you know, someone watching it at home because it's just on Netflix to them purchasing a ticket.
I guess that makes you wonder if we see, like, AMC go under and we see the further decline of theater watching, if Netflix is going to have additional charges for new releases.
That's possible. I don't know how likely that is, because I feel like at least studios are going to be more likely to just release things. I feel like studios wouldn't specifically release things like on Netflix, I guess, if that makes sense. Like, if Netflix is like funding something, I don't think they're going to like pay wallet.
Yeah. I mean, usually, what I think that would be, release it on, you can just buy it from Amazon to stream, or like Google Play to stream, stuff like that.
Yeah.
And that, not Netflix. So I wonder, I guess you could further argue if you can, like, why doesn't Netflix buy into that market?
I think it's really, it's part of their business plan, is not like, I don't know, I feel like if, like, I mean, I feel like if they're producing a film, part of the reason they're producing it, and the same thing with like their TV shows, is it's not to directly make money, it's to draw people into your streaming service. Because like, right. If you're like, because part of the thing with Netflix now is a lot of the draw is no longer, oh, there's all like these movies and shows that I like that are on it. It's like, or well, shows from other like companies or whatever are on it. It's, oh, new season of Stranger Things, or like, oh, there's a new, I don't know, this is like a new Spike Lee film that just came out on Netflix.
Right.
I can
see that. I just wonder, like, is that where they trend in the future? If they want to monopolize that market, like, why not house movies for rental, especially like newer movies, instead of waiting 3 years to get the rights to house them for free on your site?
I think part of it is like, it's just that market's already, like, I guess, saturated. Like, I don't know if... Like, I guess if, like, a new film just comes out for rent, then I guess I'm more likely to already go... It's hard to, like, break into the market when it's, like, I can rent it on Amazon or Google Play, which I'm already accustomed to, if that makes sense.
Right. I also... To kind of counter that, I guess consumers generally like to have one place for everything, I feel like.
Yeah.
And especially, like, when I think of, probably because I still have cable, but when I think of, like, renting a newer movie, I think of Xfinity and going on demand and whatnot, but not everybody has cable, which makes it even more appealing, I feel like, for Netflix to kind of start doing something like that. I feel like if movies, like, start to primarily release digitally, which definitely means, like, it has to be primarily that we see Netflix kind of trend towards that.
I could definitely see it happening. I just think it's already one of the things I like. One of the things with that is, like, there's already Netflix, like, for a long time was kind of like the streaming service, but at this point there's also, like, Hulu and Disney Plus now, and, like, I don't know, I guess Amazon Prime exists, but there's a bunch of other streaming services now,
right?
So they are, I guess, like, they already don't really have a monopoly on digital content anymore, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
So I don't know how, I guess, I don't know how substantial it would be for them to actually invest in it.
I guess time will tell. I mean, if AMD goes under, I think we'd see a significant shift.
AMD's not going under anytime soon.
They doing real good right now.
If AMC goes under, I think we'll see what happens then.
Yeah.
But I definitely expect some changes to happen on that front.
One other thing is that I think also something that might happen is we might see a trend towards less of, like, AMC type, like, just go and watch a movie, and more towards something like Alamo Drafthouse does, where it's like you can get food while you're watching a movie and there's, like, a bar and stuff.
Y'all remember Chunkies?
What?
You never went to Chunkies, Joe?
No. Is this, like, Chuck E. Cheese's fatter cousin?
No,
that's a favorite pizza.
Yeah, you go watch a movie and you'd order, like, shitty bar food.
I remember that pizza being good, but I was also, like, 10, so it was probably really bad.
Yeah,
they did have, like, really comfy chairs, though.
They did. Yeah, they were, like, race car chairs.
Yeah, they're pretty sick. But yeah, Chunkies.
I definitely think
Chunkies are still around. But...
No, I literally think they are.
They are? Holy shit, dude. Do you guys want to go to Chunkies?
No, not really.
I don't think they're open right now.
Well, not right now. Once this is
over. They do exist. If Chunkies goes under, the world ends. No, they can't. No.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Like, I think we'll see the theaters that remain will trend more towards making an experience of going to the theater rather than it just being, like, a new movie's out.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Am I alone in considering going to the theater an experience right now?
I think to some extent it's an experience, but I also think it kind of depends on the film you see. Tenet is actually, like, a good movie to test to see if audiences are, like, ready to go back to theaters, because out of all, like, the films that I'd like to see in theaters, like, a Christopher Nolan film is one that I would definitely prefer. Like, the films he makes are very, like, cinematic experiences, if that makes sense.
Right.
That's true.
I mean, I saw, just on the topic of, like, the theater being an experience, I saw Once Upon a Time in Hollywood in theaters for the first time with all my friendos, two of which are in this chat.
Yeah.
Oh, fuck.
And I had a ball just because, like, you couldn't get that experience just watching it at home. Like, everybody laughing, just, like, I don't know, like, the whole theater, like, being engaged in this, this film. It just feels like you're a part of that experience, and I mean, I value that a lot more than watching it at home. I think I'm much more invested in a film at the theater as well.
Yeah.
I guess I'm going to be the dissenting opinion and say a movie theater, I think, in my opinion, only really flourishes with movies that are like big, loud and in your face. Like, I think if I went to see, for example, I saw Parasite a couple weeks ago. If I went to see Parasite in the movie theaters, I don't think I would have had any drastic experience compared to sitting in my living room and watching it there. But I've seen Jurassic Park in theaters. And that movie, especially, like, what always sticks in my mind is when the T-Rex roared and the entire theater was filled with this screech of, I think the T-Rex is like metal, just metal scraping. But the whole theater, like, I was massively overwhelmed in that moment by that screech. And I think something like that, movie theaters, that's where they really flourish. But like, if you're going to watch an Adam Sandler rom-com, keep it at home. You're not really gaining anything by spending an extra $6-7 for the big screen.
Are you kidding?
That's where you're wrong.
I would have paid so much money to see Jack and Jill in theaters.
Had I known what a masterpiece it would become.
Oh my god.
Hopping back on Jason's point, I can't remember the last time I went to a movie theater without my friends. Like, it's always just been like,
yeah,
the experience of going, getting a group of people together, having fun. And I don't know if that will ever be like really recouped after Corona. Like, I hope so, because it was fun. But it's just like, I feel like movie theater is gonna have to make changes. I don't know what will come with that.
I really think they should start playing classics too, more often than not. I would love to see that.
I know there are theaters that are more like private theaters rather than a big chain that do like old movie nights and stuff where they just play classics. And that's something that's like definitely really appealing, I think. Like, there are a ton of like classic movies that I'd love to just like go and see in a theater with a bunch of people. Because I think it would be like a very engaging experience, especially since it's not, for a lot of people, like, I don't know, there's a lot of people who like, I guess, couldn't see like The Empire Strikes Back in theaters. But like, I would really enjoy going and seeing that movie in theaters. I think that would be a really fun experience.
I know. I totally agree. I was just gonna mention the Cabot in Beverly does the same thing, and the Coolidge Corner in Boston. It's worth noting that these are both private theaters. And I think that AMC could benefit from doing something like that too, but it seems like they just never have been interested in screening old movies.
Yeah.
I mean, they occasionally, they have like events, like there would be like for this one weekend they have a movie back in theaters or something like that, but they never create as much buzz as like new movie releases, so I don't think they saw that as really a profitable avenue.
I mean, I think part of that is because when you have like a privately owned theater, a lot of the time there's like a lot of like a lot of the time where these theaters are located, and what they do is like kind of like build up a community around them. So they'll have like, when they have a movie night, it's not just I go see movie in theater. It's like, you know, you hang out with people and you have a fun time. And it's like a different atmosphere, basically.
Yeah.
To an AMC. And it's definitely something I think AMC could have capitalized on. I think it's a missed opportunity, in my opinion, to not have, I guess, at least tried that.
Wow. Alrighty. Yeah.
All right.
Movies. Cool.
News. Cool.
Wow.
Die. Yeah.
We're gonna die? What?
Yeah, without movies. Quentin Tarantino will never make his 10 movies, whatever.
Didn't he? Wasn't it only 9?
It's only 9?
No, it's 10. It's 10.
Is it?
He described his last movie as epilogue-y, I believe.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so it's going to be... I think it's going to have a lot of homages to his past 9 movies. But yes, he vowed for 10.
Okay. Well, are we finished with this topic?
I think so.
All right, well, in that case, we can move on to the cool album that we listened to. Cold. It's a cold and a fact.
It's a fact. This
album oh, is boy. A cold fact.
Yeah, so what did everyone think of Cold Fact by Rodriguez?
Good. You had some choice words earlier, and I want to hear it again.
Wow. Okay, so, my first impression of Sugar Man goes like this and fall. Goes like this, right? It's math rock, but Jimi Hendrix. That is no longer my opinion, but for some reason that was the first thing that came into my head, and I thought it was very funny.
I don't know why this is the first thing that came into your head.
I honestly don't know either, but that was what popped into my brain was Jimi Hendrix math rock.
I want Jimi Hendrix to do math rock now.
Too bad he's dead.
Shit.
What's it called?
Yo, spoilers.
Sorry, did you not catch up to the series?
No, I haven't. I've been rewatching it on Netflix.
I see. Yeah. Sometime around episode like 15, about 20 minutes in, Jimmy ends up having a drug overdose. It's a real bummer.
Fuck. Damn it. Yeah.
But back to Cold Fact. Not Jimi Hendrix, but Rodriguez. I thought it's real solid. It's definitely got that sort of 1970s flair. I had the second thing that I thought of was, wait a minute, when did Neil Young put out Searching for a Heart of Love? Because it felt very much that, like, I was pretty sure it was the 70s, but I had to check to make sure. And wouldn't you know it, 1972, he put out, I just looked at the album and now I've already forgotten the name. Harvest, there we go. He put out Harvest in 1972, so this is 2 years after Cold Fact. But it very much has that feeling of the era, that sort of, I think Brendan called it blues rock sort of style. And I was told, now I'm not sure if you guys knew this, the gentleman who decided he couldn't make it on the show had mentioned that in the Netflix documentary Searching for Sugar Man, this album was not very popular in the United States because of its focus on apartheid. And thinking about that in the time, obviously, in 1971, the Kent State shooting happened. So it's not that the United States wasn't in a politically like spent situation. It's just for whatever reason, apartheid wasn't on anyone's list. And I think that's bizarre because this is a real solid album, you know?
Yeah. That's interesting. I didn't.
Yeah. Just so you know, none of us have watched the documentary.
So I didn't really get a chance to listen to this album in depth. But I think that this album is a good modernization of, more classic bluesy, into rock styles of the late 1950s, earlier 1950s. Especially on the Gamora. I thought that drawl he has throughout the entire song with that very simple riff was engrossing, even though it was pretty simplistic. And then, obviously, lyrically, it's a pretty strong song as well.
I personally didn't... I mean, there's definitely a blues rock influence on this album, but for me, I guess I felt more of, like, the folk influence. Because to me, it felt like he kind of took folk music and added a lot of, like, psychedelic elements to it. That I think made it really interesting. It kind of comes up like a lot on the first track, Sugar Man, which like there's like all sorts of like weird like noises throughout the track that are add a lot to it. And especially on the first track, I think a lot of this album has kind of this like sort of like depressing vibe that comes off a lot of the tracks, which is partially due to the lyrics of a lot of the tracks, which are very they're very political, but also there's a lot that are just I believe just about relationships, which I think is also interesting how the album kind of goes between these political tracks and these like songs about a relationship he had or something.
Definitely. I definitely see what you mean about socially psychedelic sections. I didn't think about with Sugar Man, but with Only Good for Conversation, there was... I really noticed the sort of distorted guitar whines.
Yeah.
And I was like, this is very much... this is definitely like to be expected of some of the psychedelic sort of genre. So I totally get what you're saying.
Yeah, I agree. I think that he uses instrumentation very wisely on a lot of these tracks, in my opinion. Like he on Sugar Man, I think is probably the best song here, because it sounds great. But like the way he has all these odd sounds, as Joe mentioned, really bring the track together. And even the way he peels back instrumentation on songs like Gamora, I think, work really well.
I will say that on some of the tracks here, I wish he went more in with, or he went further with his experimentation. I do think there are a few tracks that get a bit too, like, I guess basic sounding in a way, where I think some of the more out there elements on other tracks would have helped with them.
Yeah, I kind of want to see more in-depth in subject matter too, because none of these songs last much longer than 3 minutes or so. The whole album is only 32 minutes long. And it makes some very powerful statements in that time, but you never get the storytelling that I think could be there.
I kind of disagree with that. I think for me, probably actually the strongest part of this album is Rodriguez's lyricism.
No, don't get me wrong. I love the lyricism. I just want more of it.
Okay. Yeah, I can see where you're coming from. Because it's definitely... I guess I didn't notice it on my first few listens, but, like, he's... A lot of the lyrics on this album are very beautifully put. It's pretty poetic in a lot of ways, and it gives us, like, a real beauty to a lot of the tracks. That I think might be lacking if the lyrics weren't so captivating.
Yeah. You're right.
Thank you. I'm glad you agree with me.
I agree with you, Joe.
I'm glad you agree with me? Wait.
We're so good at agreeing.
Wow. We should.
What's it called? This isn't specifically about this album, but I guess more about the era in which it came out. And I was just, I was kind of thinking to myself, because, you know, and this will date this episode massively, but probably not now that I think about it. We are currently in some massive political strife, and I'm just thinking to myself, a lot of the big songs that, like, a lot of the songs that ended up hitting the charts that were anti-war songs were never really... They always had this sort of bluesier, folksy style, and I guess maybe that was just the tastes of the market at the time. But it's kind of, I don't know. It's interesting because the music that I've listened to recently, AJJ, for those of you who enjoy them, Good Luck Everybody came out. And that was kind of, there were plenty of songs that were very aggressive and very angry. And they were overtly angry. And I kind of find it fascinating how Rodriguez is able to collect the same sentiment that other bands have, and rather than going for a more aggressive, more overtly, I'm going to punch you right in the face sort of method, he goes with songs like Rich Folks Hoax, where he's very clear on what he's going at, where it's like the rich folks are taking advantage of the poor. But he still is able to put this all together in this haunting yet beautiful track that really makes you go, huh, good point.
Yeah, it's definitely.
Very exasperated, huh, good point.
Yeah, a little bit.
It's definitely something to note. Is, a lot of the time when artists make political music, it's the songs that are successful are the ones that aren't, I guess, very specific. They don't, a lot of the time it's in especially the Vietnam era, a lot of the political tracks weren't like, I guess, calling things out. It was more like, this war needs to end, or like, we just want peace and stuff like that. Which I think could have contributed to why this album wasn't like a mainstream success. Which is really unfortunate because it's really entertaining. I think more so a lot of it is definitely stuff that really makes you like, I guess, think about or about what he's talking about.
For sure.
Yeah, I mean, also, as for being a mainstream success, I don't really think that this is a sound that people were really looking for at this time. I mean, like, I don't know. The turn into the 70s, I feel like folk is kind of on its way out.
These are all excellent points you two have pointed out, and it really, really kind of helps me see the bigger picture, I guess.
Wow. Cool.
Beautiful.
Beautiful.
Listen, let me send props where props are due. I didn't think about these things until you two presented them, and it makes me go, huh. I guess that we're kind of putting together why this album wasn't as successful as it should have been, because I opened this conversation with it wasn't successful despite the country being in such a politically tumultuous time, you know? Yeah. And now we're starting to put it together. The sound is a little off. It's a little too cutting into what it is as opposed to being kind of broad and more a general idea.
Yeah.
That's why we discuss albums together, because we each can play off each other's strengths. Wow.
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 Except for Joe, because his opinions are all bad.
I'm sorry. Brendan.
Yes.
You agree with me on some of my opinions, though.
I do.
That means at least some of your opinions are bad.
A lot of my opinions are bad, let's be honest.
Damn. All right, which ones though? Okay, what's your worst opinion?
Make Believe is actually a 10 out of 10.
Okay, that's a really bad opinion.
Yeah, it is. Any closing remarks? You?
I want to listen to it again.
Well, you can go on to www.spotify.com and click on play or something. I don't know how Spotify works.
Browser Spotify,
yes.
Yes.
It's the true Spotify fans' way of streaming.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. I think this is definitely a very engaging album. This is not a song, it's an outburst, or the Establishment Blues. I will admit that I think, there's like, he has some lyrics that maybe didn't age as that well. Specifically, he says the system is going to fall soon to an angry young tune, and that's a concrete cold fact, which I don't know, the system didn't really fall. If I'm being honest.
Yeah, but he can dream.
I can dream too.
Yeah.
Wow.
Let's take down the establishment. The four of
Let's
us.
Let's do it.
Together.
Tune in next week for our review of the Shark Boy and Lava Girl original soundtrack.
By David Bowie.
Did he actually?
No.
But what if he did, though? Okay?
That'd be great.
Like, what if he did?
Sharkboy and Lava Girl is already a 10, but, like, that would make it at least an 11.5, if we're going to be honest.
He did Labyrinth soundtrack.
He was also in Labyrinth.
Yeah, but he could have been in Sharkboy and Lava Girl. He could have been George Lopez.
Have you seen David Bowie's Crotch Bolt in Labyrinth?
Oh, I have. Dance, baby, dance. He's packing heat.
What do you guys think of Labyrinth?
It's decent.
It's nice. Yeah. Like, Jim Henson's puppet work is great. David Bowie's really fun.
Can we do that on another show?
What? Oh, review Labyrinth?
Yeah.
I'll be honest, I don't think that movie aged as well as it should have. But that's just me.
I feel like a lot of Jim Henson's movies didn't really age well because people sort of moved away from the puppeteering style.
Star Wars.
I wouldn't call Star Wars a Jim Henson movie.
Didn't he make puppets for Star Wars?
He made and Frank Oz voiced and puppeteered Yoda, but like I'm talking about like Dark Crystal and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But, like, it has Yoda.
Yes. Okay. You're right.
Wait. Did Frank Oz also puppeteer Yoda in the prequels?
I think so. Yeah.
Was he puppeteered in the prequels?
I think he was originally a puppet, and they replaced him with CG, which, thank God, because apparently they had a Yoda puppet, but, like, in the warehouse where they kept it got really hot and its like face melted into a certain position. It looks hilarious. Let me see if I can find a photo.
Well, now that we're sufficiently off topic from Cold Fact.
Yes. Cold Fact, very good album. I do wish that it maybe went a bit more into like the kind of experimental psychedelic stuff he was messing around with, but I still really enjoyed it. I think it's like an 8 out of 10. If we're doing ratings.
We're doing ratings.
Alright.
I also really enjoy this album. It's got a lot of cool sounds, a lot of cool messages. There's a lot to love here. I'm feeling like an 8 to an 8.5 out of 10.
Whoa.
One of you has to go.
I'm gonna say a preliminary 7, but I have to listen to it again.
Okay.
And I, you know what? I don't even want to give a rating, so just erase that. I have to listen to it again out of 10.
Honestly, I think I'm gonna. Honestly, makes it sound like I'm gonna give it a 4. I think I'm gonna sound redundant. I'm gonna sound like a sellout, but you know what? That's the game we're playing today. I think I would give this album an 8. I could definitely see myself going back and listening. I can't remember which track it is, but I remember at some point he says something about the young folks, and it's gonna haunt me forever. And I know for a fact, tomorrow at work, something's gonna be stuck in my head, and I'm gonna go, all right, when I go on my break, I'm gonna have to play the album again. So yeah, I think it's a solid 8.
Yeah.
Wow. Thank you, Rodriguez, for cold fact.
Yes.
What do you think Ben Shapiro would do if he got his hands on this album? Like, he just has this album in one hand and like a Logic album in the other hand.
This is a very interesting question, Brendan. I'm gonna let you deal with that.
Wait, but Logic is hip hop, and according to Ben Shapiro, that's not music. So.
Damn.
What cold fact? More like cold take.
I don't know if that works.
Checkmate, liberals.
Like, I don't know. Cold take is like, you say like, I don't know. You say like, fucking Abbey Road is a 10. Like, that's a cold take.
I've never seen Abbey Road. I don't think any of us ever have.
Seen Abbey Road? What?
Yeah, have any of us watched an episode of Abbey?
I'm guessing Ben Shapiro.
Abbey. Shit.
Ben Shapiro would disagree with a lot of the things that Rodriguez is saying on this album.
Yes, he probably would.
Ben Shapiro would like be the guy that wouldn't even listen to like the lyrics that hard, though.
I would like the world to know that Rodriguez, his first name is his official name. Is Sixto Diaz Rodriguez. He was born in Detroit, Michigan in 1942. He is still alive, just very old.
Let's go.
Well, thank you.
Thanks for being alive.
I don't know if that's like an achievement to like, you're still alive.
To be, what is
it? Good job.
Well, it is.
I don't know.
It is a big deal because apparently, people began to rumor that he had commit suicide after releasing his second album because he was just such an enigma that no one knew anything about him.
Wow. Oh, damn.
Yeah. But now he's alive.
Probably could see him in that Netflix documentary that we didn't watch.
Yeah. That would have been, like, a really good thing to do for this episode, is, like, watch the documentary and then talk about it, but we didn't.
Yeah, because we're good at podcasting.
Yeah. Yes. Alright, let's talk about movies. We watched some cool movies.
Yeah.
Wow.
Wow.
Wait, are we
starting out with Endgame?
I guess so.
Okay.
Have either of you guys watched Endgame recently?
No spoilers.
I have literally never watched Endgame, but I know plenty of spoilers about it. I had a group of friends that, it was like 10 of them that all got together for a midnight viewing of it, and they were destroyed the next day because they all had class at 6 in the morning, so they only got like 3 hours of sleep. But they were like, this was amazing. Loved it. So yeah,
I have not watched Endgame either.
Okay, so this is we're really good at planning these things, you know.
Okay.
I'm guessing,
there's two things you have to know about Endgame. One, Ant-Man climbs up Thanos' asshole and then starts expanding, and Thanos explodes.
Yeah.
And then two, when Thanos comes back from the alternate timeline, Ant-Man gets bigger, puts Thanos in his asshole and then drinks.
That's why Thor becomes fat, right? Because he has to eat to cope with the trauma.
Yes.
Of what he saw?
The horrors. It's really interesting that it was rated PG-13. There was a lot of blood.
God.
Are we actually, getting into it? Was there a lot of blood?
No. I mean, it's a Marvel movie. There's, characters have, blood on them, dried blood and stuff. Yeah. I don't know. Well, they don't usually show that much blood in Marvel movies.
I know character gets his ass kicked and commits Sudoku, but I didn't know if character was especially bloody when he commits Sudoku.
Wait.
Who?
Oh, are you talking about Black Widow kills
no.
him? Did she get... No?
I forgot that happens. I'm talking about at the very end.
Oh, wait.
Iron Man? What?
Iron Man?
Yeah. Well, Jason said no spoiler.
No, I was joking. This is a joke.
Oh, okay.
About the movie.
Okay, Iron Man, he doesn't really, I guess, kill himself. He uses the Infinity Stones to snap. He snaps all of Thanos' boys away.
Yeah.
And then using them, kills him.
Yeah.
Wow.
The end.
So yeah, you guys understand what happens in Endgame. Moving on, let's talk about it. Great memes, gotta say.
Great memes. There's not as many memes in this movie as there are in Infinity War, I have to say.
That's true, there are not.
In Infinity War, it was legitimate. It didn't ruin Infinity War or anything. It was just kind of distracting, because in the climax, there's 10 memes in a 15 or 10 minute span. So the entire time you're just oh yeah, that.
Brendan,
that was yes. how I felt watching JoJo.
The last time I was on, in the Lost episode, you mentioned that you did not like the part where a certain character in Black Panther said, "What are those?"
Oh yeah.
And you had mentioned that a similar thing happened in Endgame.
So there's two things that happened in Endgame. One, Hulk dabs, because...
Oh my god! That's, amazing, though. That, hurts so good.
So, yeah, so they're, eating food in a diner. It's Black Widow, Ant-Man, Captain America, and the Hulk. And the Hulk is smart now. They call him Smart Hulk in the subtitles.
It's just Professor Hulk.
They call him Smart Hulk in the subtitles.
Smart Hulk, okay.
And they're eating, and then some kids come up to the Hulk and just be like, "Hey Hulk, can we get a photo with you?" And then he does, and he dabs on the haters. And then there's another point. So they have to recruit Thor, who's been depressed because all of his friends are dead, pretty much.
Good reason.
Or, well, that's not really why he's depressed. It's that, or, well, all his friends are dead,
it's really all his family failed
to stomp Thanos.
Yeah.
He didn't go for the head.
Yeah.
Yeah, he kind of blames himself for everybody dying. But, right. It's whatever, you know? And so he's kind of depressed, and so he's a hole up in his room, constantly getting drunk and playing Fortnite.
Wait, actually?
Yes, yeah, no. Actually.
Yeah, Thor is playing Fortnite.
Korg and, Meek, yeah.
I'm sorry, he's actually playing Fortnite?
No, yeah, he's actually playing Fortnite.
When we see him, he's not playing Fortnite, but Korg and Meek are playing
Fortnite.
I assume that Thor also plays Fortnite.
Yes. It's implied that Thor plays Fortnite.
Exactly. Yes. At one point, he gets on the comms and calls Noobmaster 69... he threatens to wipe him off the face of the earth.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, I'm honestly, when I saw Endgame in theaters, I was not okay with the dabbing one. I am now way more okay with the dabbing one. The dabbing one
is amazing.
The Fortnite one's still kind of cringe, though, gonna be honest.
It is a little bit cringe. It's at least Korg, so it's amazing because it's Korg, but is a bit cringe. It will not age well. I guarantee you that.
All right, if Thor was playing, all right, which game would Thor have to be playing for it to not be cringe?
Minecraft.
If he was, yo, if they're playing Minecraft, oh my god. That,
they could have had Minecraft and you just rebuilt Asgard in Minecraft.
Yes, that's what I'm thinking. It's like they could have a joke where they're like, you know, Hulk and whoever else is like, Thor, are you okay? And they see he's like rebuilt Asgard in Minecraft and they're like, uh oh.
Yeah. That has some dark connotations.
So anyways, missed opportunity on Disney's part. Yo, what if he was playing, what's a Disney game?
Epic Mickey. Oh, yeah. Lego the Avengers?
That'd be very meta.
Yo, that would actually be really good.
Side tangent. Did you guys know that Epic Mickey was a pain in the neck to try to license because somebody else, not Disney, owned the rights to Oswald the Lucky Rabbit?
Really?
And yeah, so it took for the studio to even start making the game. Disney first had to own the rights to Oswald the Lucky Rabbit, so it pushed them back like 3 months.
Damn. Wow.
Yeah.
Epic.
That's pretty epic. Wow.
Anyways, Avengers Endgame.
Yeah, so Endgame is a good conclusion to the MCU.
It very much is.
Wow.
I think it's really cool. It takes a bit of a darker tone compared to a lot of pretty much the entire rest of the MCU, considering like everybody's dead and you get to see the survivors just being like, fuck, everybody's dead. And
there is it's like weird. There's a darker tone, but
it gets lighthearted
it starts to get very lighthearted at certain points.
Yeah.
I'd say it's like, compared to like Infinity War, it's a bit lighter hearted. Because it's less about them, everyone, it's less about everyone dying and more about getting everyone back, so.
Yeah.
But yeah, wow. It's like, it's solidly put together.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, the music. I don't think we've really mentioned music for most of the Marvel movies because
we mentioned it for like Doctor Strange, I think.
And yeah,
Guardians, because obviously.
Most of the time the music in Marvel movies is just like
there.
And it's like, it's not like the worst thing ever, but it's like, it's not good. And I think, unfortunately, that's something that hurts Endgame a lot, is the music is very overbearing at points. Especially during the sad points, where I feel like it could have been a lot more impactful if they just lightened up on the music.
Perhaps. I definitely think that it could have been formatted better, but coming away from it, I don't think it really impacted my experience that much. To be honest. I really, because like, I remember the moments themselves and not as much what was going on around, I guess. Because like, okay. I don't know. There are definitely some very memorable moments in Endgame, and we're going to spoil the entire fucking thing.
We've already spoiled all of it. What are you
that's true. Anyways, but like the moments when like,
also, who that would be listening to this wouldn't like already know what the fuck happens in Endgame. Like you have to be like living under a rock at this point to like not have any clue what happened.
That's fair. but rocks are very cheap nowadays. Just saying. Anyways.
What?
Real estate jokes.
Those are really bad joke. I'm not gonna.
Well,
real estate joke?
It's free real estate.
Wow.
It's a free house.
That's like when Hulk dabbed. It reminds me. It's so current.
Yes.
Man.
Anyways, yeah. Endgame. I like Endgame a lot. Honestly, I feel like having watched all the Marvel movies in about the past month, the payoffs in Endgame are way, way better than having watched all the Marvel movies in the past 12 years.
Yes. Definitely.
So good on that.
It feels very final for the MCU.
It does.
Like, I don't want to watch any more Marvel movies now. I'm, like, done with them. Like, there's, like, a few that I haven't watched, or I guess rewatched still, and I'm like, I don't care.
Mm-hmm.
I'm good to just not watch those for a while. Because, I don't know, it just feels like
it's over.
The MCU is, like, done. Like, if it ended right now, I'd, like, it's, like, yay.
It's sad to see things go, but sometimes things do have to end for them to be at a good conclusion.
Yeah. I think Endgame is a great conclusion, honestly.
Like, I don't... Like, why go past Endgame?
Money.
Yeah, exactly.
I do know Marvel has also been doing... Or, I guess their plan is not, like... At least from what I've seen, is it's like there aren't like more Avengers movies or anything like that. It's just like more solo, offshoot projects. I believe they're ones that are like that are, I guess. I believe Disney has been giving directors more creative control, which is nice. Basically, I think they're going to be going into like. More like one-off stories rather than, you know,
connected universe.
Yeah. I have no doubt that that will still be present, but I think it'll be present to a much lesser extent.
Yeah.
Wow.
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 Wow. Wow.
Wow. Wow. Anyway, yeah. Endgame is my favorite Marvel Cinematic Universe movie.
Really?
Yes.
I thought you were going to say Thor Ragnarok.
No. Thor Ragnarok's up there. Thor Ragnarok, easily top five. You know?
I have not seen Ragnarok. Yo, what the fuck?
You gotta see Thor Ragnarok. It's one of the best.
I don't watch a lot of Marvel movies now, I think. I don't watch a lot of movies.
What We Do in the Shadows.
But now that you guys have finished watching all of the Marvel movies, I think I'll start watching them myself.
Wow.
Perfect timing.
Great timing.
Like, it's not... It's definitely, like... going through them, it's more... It's generally more good than bad.
Yeah, it's very inconsistent at the start, though.
Yeah, for the first two phases, it's pretty inconsistent, and then once you get to phase three, it's like, generally the movies are solid.
Yeah.
Was the MCU, a cohesive vision at that point?
Oh, yeah.
Like, at the early phases? Yeah.
I don't know if it was necessarily, like, a cohesive vision, because a lot of the early movies still feel like they're trying to get the grasp on what to do with it.
Mm-hmm.
But it... Also, compared to, like, DC's shit, it feels like... I'm so pumped for the Snyder Cut. compared to, like, DC's stuff, what Marvel has going for it is it's... The build-up feels natural.
Yeah, it definitely takes its time with that as well.
Because, like, I don't know, the first Iron Man was, like, 2008.
Yep.
And then it took, like, 4 years for the first Avengers movie. So, like, it definitely took having it be like, it feels less like they had like a vague plan probably for, yeah,
even back in Iron Man 1 we have S.H.I.E.L.D. introduced.
Yeah.
Rest in peace, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., by the way, if anyone remembers that show.
Is it, like, done now?
It's been done for years.
Oh, okay, I don't know. There is fucking, I think I watched, like, up to through the fourth season, and then, like, I just stopped.
Agent Coulson was a character, and then they killed him off in the MCU, so they killed him off in the show, and then the show just ended.
Wait, they killed Coulson in
it? Yeah, Coulson's been dead for a while.
Oh, fuck.
That's why he never shows up in any of the movies.
Damn he shows it.
Back up in Captain Marvel.
He does. He?
Well, doesn't Captain Marvel happen in the past?
Yeah, it happens. Captain Marvel's a prequel.
He also has a really, like,
weird haircut.
Weird haircut, yeah. It's very distracting, I have to say.
We're talking a lot about the Marvel Cinematic Universe and then DC's attempt at a cinematic universe. But what we should really be talking about is Warner Brothers' Dark World universe.
Yo, the Dark Universe? Oh my god, I'm so excited. Because, you know, it's such a complete vision. We got The Mummy. And then it was cancelled. Because the Mummy didn't necessarily, I mean, so like, the mummy technically made back its budget, but they had poured a fuck ton of money into it.
Yeah.
Because it was supposed to be the start of their Dark Universe. So it like actually did really poorly.
I want just an entire cinematic universe based on Tom Cruise.
Can't you just like piece together all the movies he's been in?
Yes.
Like, he basically plays the same character in every movie, so.
Please tell me where Magnolia fits into that. Where everyone is just really fucking miserable.
They realize who Tom Cruise really is. Scientology.
Damn. Oh, that's the key. You link it together with Scientology.
Scientology links everything together, Joe. You just haven't seen that yet.
By the way, there is a Scientologist church in Quincy.
Let's go.
Yo.
My buddy almost got roped into a Scientologist church because he applied to it as a joke, and then they responded to his email, and he started freaking out because they started like, oh, we'll meet up in this public area and such a thing, and we'll talk and see if you have the midichlorians or whatever it is that they look for.
Please, oh man, I wish I was part of Scientology.
It is, there's something like that.
There is, Scientology's fucking, what a beautiful religion, you know?
It makes sense when you think
about it,
okay? Just saying.
I'm sorry, I misspoke, I meant cult. but yeah.
Yeah, Scientology. This is now a Scientology podcast.
Wait, what?
Whatever. What is? I already forget the acronym. Would that have gotten us canceled though? Just talking trash about Scientology?
No. Who cares about Scientology? I don't even know. I believe it does fall under free speech to talk about religion.
Yo, nice.
You just can't talk bad about Scientology if you're a part of Scientology.
Yeah, because then you get kicked out of Scientology Club, but we're not in Scientology Club.
And kneecapped.
Yeah. Okay, so we're going to have meetings on the third floor of Ben's bathroom. It's free to get in, okay, but it's $80 to leave.
I like this business model.
This is very good.
It's not entrapment. You can leave at any time. You just need to give us the money first.
Yes. Credit cards will also work.
It's like those, they used to, you have like doors where you have to like put a quarter in to turn the handle, right? You just do that on the way out.
Wait, is that a thing?
Yeah. They back in the day, they used to make those for like stall doors for bathrooms.
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of fucked up.
Yeah, they didn't last very long.
Wow.
Also, I don't know. They don't seem very effective. People, you can just like crawl under the door or over the door. Like,
oh, public bathroom doors, like public bathroom floors.
Yeah, but if I got a pee and I don't have a quarter, like, fuck it.
Exactly.
There wasn't coronavirus back then. Like, whatever, man.
Yeah, but there was E. coli.
E. coli is not that bad. It's good for your immune system. Like, come on.
Fight me, E. coli.
E. coli is a weak bacteria.
Whoa.
Gram negative.
Tell that to my granddad.
Little baby bacteria.
Did your granddad die of E. coli? I'm very sorry.
He didn't die of E. coli, but he got E. coli twice in 1 year, and then he also got pancreatic cancer.
Yeah. That was a bad year.
That's a bad year.
It was a bad year. I still miss him.
Sorry for that loss, and also sorry for laughing.
No, it's alright. At this, I think he would have laughed too. Because it is just, it's a bad sequence of events. But yeah. What were we talking about?
Avengers Endgame.
There we go. And then Spider-Man gets E. coli in the shawarma bathroom. And your grandfather, Far From Home.
Your grandfather's with Xenu now. It's okay.
Alright. Speaking of cults, I feel like we've talked about Endgame enough, and we should move on to some other movies we've been watching. Harry Potter. Yes.
So, Harry Potter is your normal, everyday slave in the Dursley's house. And then, sometimes you just turn out to be a wizard.
A what?
He's a wizard.
He's a wizard, Harry.
But he's just Harry.
No. You see, he's actually Harry Potter.
A wizard celebrity that he doesn't even know it. And then he joins the wizard world and everybody's like, Harry Potter. Yeah.
I don't think that's
the entire first movie.
The end. Does he
slam some Asian chick by Deathly Hallows or something?
He's like 11 in the first movie.
Yeah. I think in the fifth book that happens.
I think in the fourth book he starts like getting googly eyes for Cho.
Let's not get ahead of ourselves here.
Yeah, we'll talk about Cho Chang next week and Harry Potter's Yellow Fever.
So Brandon. No.
All right.
So which Harry Potter movie did you guys watch? Because that might mean that I might have seen it.
We watched the first two.
I have seen those.
And Chamber of Secrets. Also, Sorcerer's Stone, also called Philosopher's Stone, depending upon where you are, apparently.
You see, we're stupid Americans, and we don't understand what philosophers are.
It's a mythological object. I don't understand why people
It tested better with audiences. I don't fucking know.
I guess. People are dumb.
It's just how marketing works. Yeah. People are more familiar with sorcerers. It might catch more people's eyes or something.
Who the fuck cares about philosophy, am I right?
But like, Like Nicholas Flamel was like an actual guy, and like people actually thought he created a stone for eternal life, and he was a philosopher because that's what everybody was back in the day. That's what science was.
Actually, in the Harry Potter movies, he's actually a sorcerer.
He is actually a sorcerer in the Harry Potter movies. And he did actually create a stone for eternal life in the Harry Potter movies, which is pretty sick if you think about it. And he's also the only one that seems to have done that.
I said, what the hell I care about Aristotle's pebbles?
Dude, Aristotle giant pebbles. Oh my god.
Let's talk about how Hagrid raids their house and turns his cousin into a pig.
Okay, oh, he only gives him a pig tail. It's not an entire pig.
And he bends steel with his bare hands.
Yo, Hagrid's fucking strong. Hagrid's, right?
Yeah, he's like half giant, so.
Yeah.
But anyways, the real cool part is how.
It's not looking at the implications of that, by the way.
Not yet, alright.
What's the real cool part, brother?
As when Harry Potter sets a python on his cousin Dirt. And
oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Or, well, he, like, sort of does. He, like, frees
yeah.
the python on accident, and it's like, thank you. And then it, like, it slithers away, and then, was Dudley, he gets trapped yeah. in the python cage.
Is his name really Dudley Dursley?
Yeah.
Damn, Uncle Vernon hated his kid. Anyways. So, yeah, Harry Potter is... cool wizard, he gets to go to magic school, and the music's all like
it's yeah. like a really fucking good score.
It
like
really
the score is.
Is
like actually one of the best scores ever.
John Williams is so good at music.
Damn.
Wow. Thank you, Mr. Williams. He deserves all the he's gotten so many awards for it, but he deserves more. Anyways.
Wow.
Then he goes to school and everybody's like, oh my god, you're Harry Potter, I'm gonna come. And then,
they're not, alright.
No, cool. Yeah, that's pretty much how it works. And everybody's like, oh my god, Snape's evil. And then they try and stop Snape. Fuck. They try and stop Snape, but it wasn't Snape, it was Voldemort. And then, Harry kills Voldemort. And the man who was
kind
of being a host for Voldemort. It's implied he kills Voldemort, sort of, as well.
No, he doesn't.
But then Voldemort, like, comes back.
Is Voldemort?
No, Voldemort literally flies away. What are you talking about?
Well, it's not like...
He flies through Harry.
That's not like Voldemort, though.
Yeah, he's not at full power. He just...
Yeah.
Harry doesn't kill him.
That's not even his true form.
Did you ask if Voldemort was a person, Jason?
No, I said, is he a parasite?
Oh, is he a parasite?
Yeah, in the first movie.
Book more or less.
Thing, yeah, we're talking about the movies. We all read the books, mostly. But we're talking about the movies here, for clarification. Anyways. Yeah, Harry Potter literally just kills a man. He's like totally fine with it. He's like 11.
I mean, I don't know. It's not really his fault. He just kind of touches him, and, like, he burns to death.
Okay, but, like, he touches him. He realizes that the guy burns when he touches him, and then he touches him more
to kill him. I didn't know he was going to kill him.
Well, yeah, I feel like he could figure that one out. I feel like he put two together. All right,
that's fair. I don't know.
Is it explained why touching him kills him?
It's because, well, I don't remember if it is specifically, but isn't it?
No, yeah, like, it's because Harry is so pure, I believe.
Is that in the movies?
No, oh wait, no. Is it...
I thought it was like, well, I mean, I thought like actually what it was because Harry is like a Horcrux or whatever.
I think that's explained later, but the way, because Dumbledore yeah. gives some like BS excuse in the movie for why he burned Quirrell.
Harry doesn't fucking know. He's a stupid kid.
Yeah.
I have to say, the Harry Potter movies have like literally the best casting in any movies series.
Pretty much like, every character is just like perfect for their role.
Yeah, like it's not everyone feels like they're born for that role. Yeah.
No, I agree, and that's why they're continually associated with those roles.
Yeah.
No, yeah. I literally also, can't think of any character, even like minor characters like Neville and stuff that are wrong.
I mean, I guess Neville's like, I don't know, Neville becomes like super handsome and good looking in the later movies because
but they didn't know that when he was 11.
Yeah.
Big respect to Rupert Gint for going on to be a member of Thunderpants.
Rupert Grint?
Yeah.
Or wait, Weasley. Ron Weasley.
Ron Weasley. Yeah. He ends up getting a role in Thunderpants.
Wow. I think
that really was what defined his career.
Not Harry Potter, definitely.
No.
Dude, I remember being
Have you seen on Thunderpants?
Yep. Was it Emma Watson's in that movie? I was thinking of like Emma Watson now, and I was like, who's Emma Watson? It's like, no, she's 11. She looks way different. Not prepared. But anyways, yeah. First movie, good.
It's decent.
It's decent. It's like, I don't know, it's been a hot ass minute since I read any of the books.
Yeah.
The books have a lot of detail, and it's hard to transfer that to movies, but I think they did actually a very, very solid job.
Wow.
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 Anyways, I had the...
Oh, wait, can I also mention that Hagrid constantly is like...
Oh, the running
joke. He just, like, and, like, accidentally says things that he's not supposed to tell, like, the kids. He's just like... he says a bunch of shit to them.
Yeah. Nah, he knew what he was doing.
Wow.
Hagrid should not have a job, honestly.
Dare you can't know. Hagrid's, like, perfect.
Like, no, don't get me wrong. Like, Hagrid's, like, really good at his job, but he also is really not good at his job. Because, I don't know, man. He also gets arrested in the second movie.
Yo, he gets fucking arrested. Yo. Damn it, Hagrid. How could you do those drugs?
Is that the one when he had the dragon? Or is that a different?
That's not the first movie.
Wait. No, he is a dragon.
Yeah.
Right? Or wait, yeah, he's a... Is it the second movie or the first one?
The first one where he has Norbert, and then Norbert dies.
No, Norbert's taken away.
Oh, no. Yeah, he gets sent to Romania.
Yeah.
Wait, is that the second movie?
I don't know which one it is.
I know we saw it. Is he the first or the second movie? I think it's the first.
We're gonna... Alright, well...
I think it's the first. Wait, no. Nuno, why did you bring this up? This is
one of those.
Well, just because I remember him, like, handing it to Ron, and he's like, "Now don't tell anybody that I have this." And then
that's
Ron
like
goes
literally
ahead
everything
and like,
Hagrid does, though.
"Hey, everybody, look at the dragon Hagrid has." And he goes, "I told you not to do this." And then the space cops come in and they're like, "We know you have the dragon. Come out with your hands up."
Oh, that's not any of these movies. I don't know what that is.
Yeah.
He has a baby dragon, but it gets taken away. He literally just like wins random critters off of people in bars, apparently. Hagrid's really good at gambling for live creatures.
Wow. I have to say, the second movie, Ron is amazing in it.
Ron's so good.
He's so good because he's constantly, like, getting beat, like, he's constantly either getting beat the fuck
he's getting
up.
Getting dunked on in the second movie. Let's be
or he's just spending like the entire time like fucking shitting his pants.
There's one. He's like vomits out slugs for a solid like 5
yes.
minutes.
He tries to like do a spell on Draco and he accidentally does it to himself. Because his wand is fucking broken.
Mm-hmm. There are so many just like
swish and flick.
Yeah.
There are so many just like good scenes. Like you take so many good stills from the movie of just Ron's different faces throughout different points in the movie. He makes so many. It's so good.
Yeah. I love that there are giant spiders, so Ron can spend more time being deathly afraid of spiders.
Yes. Doesn't help that they tried to eat him, probably.
So the dragon was in the Sorcerer's Stone.
Okay.
Oh, so he's just talking about like the little tiny dragon.
Yeah. The egg.
Yeah. Norbert.
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 Wow.
Norbert. Poor. Yeah, I do remember the Slugs. I haven't seen those movies in a while, but I do remember the Slugs.
It's like, really entertaining.
Yeah. I remember the petrified cat.
Yep.
Oh, yes, the poor Norris. Cat.
Yeah. This is honestly cute cat. They got a cute cat for that. Wow. I love Mrs. Norris.
Did Mrs. Norris survive?
Yeah, she's fine.
All right, good.
Wow. There's like, I don't know. Chamber of Secrets the entire time is kind of like a whodunit movie, honestly.
Yeah, because they're trying to figure out who opened the Chamber of Secrets.
Right.
Yeah.
Who the heir of Slytherin is.
And also where the Chamber of Secrets is.
Yeah.
It's really entertaining. Oh, also, Lockhart is fantastic in this movie. Funny.
I wish we got more of him in the second movie, honestly.
Yeah. Especially when he tries to charm Harry and Ron and, like, makes him... Or, like, he can, like... the spell backfires and he just, like, completely forgets everything.
Yep.
Wow.
It's really funny, honestly. But then we get the whole climax with Harry fighting the basilisk and then really good choreography.
He waved that sword around.
He's waving the sword around. He's moving his feet. Harry do it.
Wow, Harry do it.
He does it. It's done.
Did it. There's one scene where Harry goes into Dumbledore's office and Dumbledore has a phoenix and the phoenix just fucking dies right in front of him. Yeah. Dumbledore comes out and he's like, oh, I'm so sorry. That's so good.
I remember. And that's when he teaches him. Phoenixes don't really die. They're always reborn.
Yeah, and they have healing tears, which is the most bullshit thing ever, if we're going to be honest. Because that's just like, that's too powerful. Because like, you're practically invincible. And you just got your buddy bird here. He can just cry on you. And you're just like, yeah, fight me.
I mean, I don't know. Does it like... I don't know. We have magic. So yeah, like...
It's magic.
Well, I'm just saying, like, if you're using magic to kill people, like, you're using Avada Kedavra, and, like, I don't think Phoenix Tears heal dead people.
I don't know.
That would be, that would be an entertaining story. It's like, the Phoenix Tears heal dead people, but then it becomes a zombie movie.
Oh, man, that would have been total whiplash for sure.
Nah, dude, I'm pretty sure that's one of the Harry Potter spinoffs. It's like Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them, and the zombie Harry Potter movie, you know?
Yes. Zombieland.
That's, of course, that's it.
This was actually, 28 Days Later was actually just a spinoff of Harry Potter.
Yes. The whole time. Every single zombie movie is a Harry Potter spinoff.
Jesus Christ, Harry! They're trying to break into the house! While Harry Potter's just sitting there having a mental breakdown because he knows what he's done was wrong, but he still did it anyways.
Oh, God.
Really, the Harry Potter movies were just a tale about why you can't leave science unwatched.
Yes.
Wow.
Can I just say that all of Harry's problems would be solved if he had a gun? I'm just saying that basilisk would get fucked up.
Why were there no guns at Hogwarts?
They have magic.
Okay, but like, come on.
Okay, but what if somebody did bring a gun to Hogwarts? Like, what if one of the first years, just like, they're in the middle of class and like the teacher is like,
I feel like we shouldn't go down
the trope. Minus 10 points. We're just pulling a gun on her.
I feel like we shouldn't go down the trope front tonight, really.
Wait, have you guys never seen that copypasta of, like...
I have seen it. I know exactly what you're talking about.
Yes. Oh, man. Like, I don't know. I'm just, like, Voldemort, like, wouldn't be shit you bring an M16 against Voldemort, like, he gets one word of that killing curse out before his head is red mist, you know?
That's another thing, dude. Like, the spells take at least a full second to cast most of them.
Right.
So, well, I mean, that's... You can also, like, actually cast spells without, like, saying the spell.
If you're powerful enough.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. But
so, like...
A spell that unlocks,
you can also, like, fire a gun without saying anything.
That's true.
Imagine every time you pulled the trigger, you had to say Avada Kedavra.
Just imagine someone going around, like, killing Death Eaters, but, like, with a gun, and just going, Avada Kedavra, and fucking...
Now I'm imagining, like, an actual, like, U.S. soldier going into, like, a battlefield and be like, Avada Kedavra, motherfucker.
That is genuinely just that one video, the magic missile video, the guy standing there with the Roman candle. Magic missile! Poof. Magic missile! Poof. But with God.
Yes.
Yes. So anyways, you guys want to start a Harry Potter LARP campaign? You know, we don't have, like, actual magic, so we're going to use guns instead.
Stupefy can be a taser.
Bro, I totally got you with that. No, missed.
I'm sorry for making fun of LARPing if anybody LARPs. Also, I'm just sorry if anybody LARPs.
Sorry for making fun of
contradictory statements. Yeah.
LARPing has its crowd. And I can't judge them, but it's just not my style. It's like furries.
You can judge them.
Okay, that's a huge comparison between LARPing and furries. That's a big leap.
I mean, I get it. It's just like, whatever, they do their thing. It's not for me.
I wonder if they have a large crossover audience between those
characters. I know, I was just going to say that. Furry LARPing.
Ooh. You guys want to start a furry LARPing club?
No, because now we're getting
into LARPing Harry Potter gun club.
Kevlar and fursuits. No, that's what I'm talking about.
And a Avada Kedavra.
And Defense Against the Dark Arts should have just been like a gun safety class.
Do not aim the wand at anything that you aren't trying to spell.
Oh, we didn't even mention the Harry Potter memes in Chamber of Secrets.
There's memes?
I mean, what? There's like the one scene where he writes in the book.
Oh, yes!
All according to Keikaku.
Oh, that's a quality scene.
Yes,
it's hard to take. Like, it's a decent scene. It's hard to take it seriously because I just, like, my head is just like going straight to know you.
Yeah. I can't wait for episode 4 with the did you put your name in the Goblet of Fire?
Oh my God! Dumbledore said
calmly. I don't know why they changed it from calmly to not quite calmly, but a really good choice.
I mean, I don't know. It's like, they're different. Movies and books are completely different things. I don't really care that they changed it. It's just entertaining.
It's very entertaining. Anyways, if that's all we got for tonight, that just about wraps it up.
Oh, baby.
Wow.
Wow. Harry Potter? More like Harry Pooper, am I right? Fucking got him.
Wow. We really lowered our standard of comedy.
We did. Join us next week. We're gonna be reviewing the album Pet Sounds by the Beach Boys. often considered one of the greatest albums ever made.
Yeah, well, sure, I guess.
I'm sure Brendan will have a shitty opinion about it.
Say it's not as good as Make Believe by Weezer.
Alright, he already has a shitty opinion. Next week we'll also probably be doing the next, like, three Harry Potter movies, I'd guess.
Yeah,
we'll say the next three. We'll see. Next three is probably where we'll be.
Probably.
And yeah, we'll see everyone, or I guess we won't see everyone. We'll talk
at you more, and maybe you'll listen.
Yeah. Next week.